Never imagined that an age program might need air conditioning. We have to settle for the fans tonight, today though, sorry. I'm just curious, what difference does it make to you that God would have raised somebody from the dead 2,000 years ago? What difference does it make to you right now? Does it make any difference to you? I hope. But most of us don't ask ourselves that question. What difference does it make? I mean, what difference really does it make for you? We accept that fact. We accept it by faith. But most of us don't ever contemplate what difference it really makes that God would have raised somebody from the dead 2,000 years ago. Now, if you're a skeptic, maybe you're not religious, maybe you're not even familiar with the Christian faith or the Bible we read, none of this might even seem relevant. You might just be here because of a relative or a friend, and you're just saying, well, I'm just going to show up because it's a nice thing to do or it's the right thing to do. But there's a fact that is undeniable in history. That 2,000 years ago, an event occurred that not only shook the foundations of civilization, but is still shaking continents today. And that was that a man who was once dead was risen, was raised to life. And not only raised to life, but it was seen by hundreds and hundreds of people, alive, transformed, and it changed the world. Nothing's been the same since. Now, during my Good Friday message, I shared with you that how tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people were crucified in the 1,000 years that crucifixion was the norm of execution in the Roman and Persian world. However, we know very few of their names. Most of them are anonymous to the historical record as just simply criminals, rebels, or martyrs. None of them were innocent, and none of them claimed to be God's son, except for one. That one who was raised to life. Just as one-time atheist Lee Strobel investigated the claims of Christ, and came to believe that Jesus was indeed who he claimed to be, it is possible for you to see today that the person who died now lives. And not only does he live, but he's capable of transforming your life from darkness to light, from mediocrity to vibrancy, from despair to hope. He can make that kind of difference in your life now and today. That's exciting to me, because I realized that that's what transformed me, was a risen Savior. And I believe that's what's transformed you. And if you haven't been transformed by his love and this truth of his resurrection, then I invite you to allow him to transform you. Because that's why he came. If you're in a place in life where less and less is making sense, you wonder what your future holds, why you're here, what your life is supposed to mean, you may be in that place to consider the resurrection and its power to heal your life. See, the power, the message of the resurrection is that there is hope, that there is more to life than just mere existence, and there is a God who really does control things, and he really is in love with you, more than you can even know or understand, which you can't experience. Even if you can't get it up here, you can get it down here. The question of what happens to a person after death is one of the oldest questions that has been pondered by humanity. We see it in cave writings all the way up and, you know, or across the world. People wonder what's going to happen after death. Thousands of years ago, a man named Job, he's in our Bible, he went through some terrible times, and he asked this question. He said, if a man dies, will he live again? Now back thousands of years before Christ came, they didn't know. They had to speculate. And so on this day that we celebrate the resurrection, I want to share with you just a couple things about what other people think about what happens after you die. Seventh-day Adventists believe in soul sleep. You just kind of go to sleep, and someday you'll wake up in a new place. Jehovah's Witnesses believe only 144,000 people will end up living for eternity, and the rest will experience what's called soul annihilation. They simply cease to exist. They're no soul. They're just, again, everything's over. Done. Some, like the Hindus, the Sikhs, the Buddhists, and even the Wiccans, they claim and teach in reincarnation, where the spirit, either animal or human, is recycled from one form to another, with superior upgrade of the consciousness depending on the karma of the life that you lived. Did you know that 25% of Americans believe in reincarnation in some form? Yeah. Did you know that a fifth of people who claim to be Christians believe in reincarnation, which is a total contradiction of their biblical faith? It only shows that we don't really understand sometimes what we believe. We just grab on to whatever the fad is lately, and we say, well, that sounds logical, and never examine it against the truth. Islam believes that there's a final judgment, and one day there'll be a physical resurrection in either heaven or hell. They have this in common with Christianity and Judaism. However, they believe that after you die, you walk across a bridge, and your sins are judged on this bridge, and if there's too many of them, it carries you over the precipice into hell, where you spend eternity. And only God knows if you'll make it to heaven, because you've got to kill somebody in the name of Islam, or die in the name of Islam, to know that you're going to go to heaven. You know, I thank God that our Savior died for us. He doesn't ask us to die for him. And atheists, well, they don't believe there's any afterlife. They believe our existence on this earth is just strictly physical, that we are just like evolved animals, that we're just a higher form of animals, and we share in common with them everything, that after we die, it's over, nothing else. It's done, it's done. We cease to exist. Now, as varied as all these beliefs are, they do have one thing in common. They're all based on theory, hope, and speculation. None of these religions has a single evidentiary event that clearly defines and demonstrates what happens after death. None of the other religions on this earth have an evidentiary event that demonstrates what happens after this death, after this life. Only one, Christianity, has an evidentiary event. An event that was proven, and there's more historical basis for the resurrection than there is for many people who lived and died in the historical record. A British agnostic once said, let's not discuss the other miracles, let's discuss the resurrection, because if the resurrection is true, then all the other miracles are easily explained. And if the resurrection is not true, then all the other miracles are irrelevant. I'd like you to go with me to the scriptures, where the Apostle Paul is writing a church in Corinth, and he's describing the implications of what happened if Jesus was not raised. And these are some facts that we should consider, because if you're a Christian, you cannot be a Christian and believe in reincarnation. They're incompatible. Totally incompatible. Just let me underline that, okay? So I'm going to read this to you, and you can kind of follow along if you can see the print. Yep, okay. It comes from 1 Corinthians 15. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there's no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God. For we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But if he did not raise him, if in fact the dead were not raised, but he did not raise him if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, then we are to be pitied more than all men. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. This what-if question that Paul asks the church in Corinth is really, we have to understand that If the women had gone to that tomb and found Jesus in the grave that morning, if they found the stone still in place, we would not be here today. We would have no reason to be here today. Our faith would have no reason to exist other than to honor the teachings of Jesus, who would not have been the Christ if he was not raised from the dead. He would have just been another rabbi in a long list of Jewish rabbis. But because they found an empty tomb, because they found a stone rolled back, because they saw an angel saying, "He is not here, he is risen," because over 500 of them saw him in person, we have something different. We're here because of that. What are the implications then if Jesus wasn't raised? Well, the first thing that Paul says, if there's no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. The very foundation of our faith is based on the belief that Jesus was raised from the dead. And he was clothed with a resurrection body. Unlike what you and I carry now, but similar in some senses. Our current bodies, these, what I like to call them, earth suits. Everybody touch your hand for a minute. That's your earth suit, okay? It's a suit that you're wearing. It's a body that you're wearing. Because that's not you. Your soul inside of you is you, okay? This is simply an earth suit that is God created for our interaction in our physical world so that we could interact in a comprehensive and meaningful way with the world as it exists in a physical state. But there is something more. Because when Jesus was raised from the dead, he was raised in a body that was unlike the physical one, but still very similar. It was suited for a spiritual existence, for a spiritual dimension that we don't see at the moment. The body that Jesus was raised in had scars, just the same scars from his physical body. He was able to show the holes in his hands and the spear like spot in his side. And yet he could eat fish, he could walk through walls, unopened doors, he could vanish in a moment and reappear in a moment. You don't do that in a physical body. It's a spiritual body, a body that was created that God had and gave him for a spiritual existence for all eternity. And you know what? Every one of us is going to get one day. Isn't that exciting? Now, Paul is talking to a group of people about 20 years after the resurrection of Christ in the city of Corinth. Back in the day when we're talking about Paul talking to Romans, the Corinthians, the Corinthians didn't have a New Testament like you and I have. They didn't have a book that was nicely bound. They had scrolls of the Old Testament, and some of them even had letters from some of the apostles. But they didn't have a comprehensive New Testament. And so a lot of them had picked up erroneous beliefs about the resurrection. And so Paul endeavors in this letter to set the record straight so that the people who are there can understand the truth about Jesus and how he was raised from the dead. He states six clear truths about the what ifs. The first one is, if Christ was not raised, then all preaching is meaningless. I'd be out of a job if Christ is not raised. I have preached over 750 sermons, I calculated it. Over 750 sermons in my time of ministry. And they'd all be worthless if Christ was not raised. I sometimes wonder, though, because if I asked you what was your favorite sermon I preached last year, I probably would get a blank look. Because most people don't remember what I said 15 minutes after I say it. I hope that's wrong. I hope you remember at least one or two. But it is a tendency to just be passive listeners and not active engagers, where we take what we hear and live it. And that's, I hope, when I preach, that you take it and do more than just go in one out the other. But if Christ was not raised, then all this that we do here on Sunday morning is worthless. It's meaningless. It has no reason. My preaching is there's no purpose for it. There's no purpose for us gathering together. There's no purpose of the church. It's just like moral teachings is all we'd have of Jesus, which would be nothing more than, you know, Gandhi or one of the other great teachers of the world. But that's, fortunately, Christ is not in the grave. Second thing is, if Christ was still in the grave, then our faith is an empty fantasy. Your faith would be worthless. You've believed in vain. You are without hope. You have no future. Your faith isn't worth believing if it's based on a lie. You see, faith is only as good as the object in which it is placed. If, for example, I was to hang a light switch on the wall and not connect it to any electricity, I could tell you that'll work the lights, but it's a lie. You can flip that switch all you want and it won't make any difference. Unless it's based on truth, unless there's power connected to that switch, it's not going to work. So you need truth to believe it. For faith to be able to work, it has to be based on something that's valid. Faith is only as good as the object in which it is placed. And if Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, we'd have no basis to believe that God is a God of love and of power and in control. The events of Calvary are just a cruel reminder of our insane and useless lives. The big question would be, does evil always triumph? Does good always win over evil? Ultimately, good wins over evil. And if Christ has not been raised, then the Word of God would be a lie. The thing that we treasure as being truth, if Christ was not raised, this is not worth the paper it's written on. This building is useless, it's worthless. If Christ is not raised, all that we do is useless. Whoever denies the resurrection denies the Word of God and denies everything it entails. So the resurrection is tied very, very strongly to everything you believe. If you can't believe the resurrection, you really can't believe anything. It's all just a big joke. Third thing, though, is that if Christ is still in the grave, all of us, all Christians, are false witnesses. We're all a bunch of liars. If there was no resurrection, then every person who claims to have witnessed the risen Christ, all the people, those 500 some people that witnessed him and said they witnessed him and saw him walk around, they would be liars if that wasn't true. And here's the thing, the implication of that. If Christ was not raised from the dead, then everybody who claimed to see him was liars, who had conspired together in their lies in order to present a consistent and harmonized account. You got to have 500 some people working together saying, yeah, we're going to write up this really cool religion and we're going to deceive everybody for thousands of years. And you just imagine that, right? I can't even imagine it. It's beyond my imagination. And here's the other part. Most of those who saw Jesus died for him. Now, you can make up lies, but most of us aren't willing to die for a lie. Especially hundreds of people are not willing to die for a lie. Lee Strobel writes, people will die for the religious beliefs if they sincerely believe they are true. But people will not die for the religious beliefs if they know their beliefs are false. And the disciples were in that unique position to know without a doubt whether or not Jesus was in fact raised. They claimed to see him. They saw him. They witnessed. They touched him. They talked with him. They met him on the beach of the Sea of Galilee. And he cooked fish for them. They watched him ascend into heaven. They saw with their own eyes and touched with their own hands. And they even write that in the scriptures. What we have seen and heard, we have touched with our own hands. They were living witnesses to the resurrection. They saw the empty tomb. They saw that stone. And yet, almost every single one of those apostles who claimed to have seen him died horrible deaths, cruel deaths. Peter was crucified upside down. Matthew's body was run through with a spear. Mark was dragged through the streets of Alexandria, and his skin was torn from his body. Luke was hanged, and John was thrown into boiling oil. Paul was beheaded. They would not give up their lives for a lie. What they saw and knew, they knew that they knew that they knew. And there was no change of their minds about it. Immediately after the resurrection, the disciples went out in the streets of Jerusalem and began preaching that Jesus was in fact raised, and they were gathered by, they were arrested by the Jews, the Jewish leaders, and they were going to have them whipped, and they told them if they didn't recant, they would be tortured. This is, do what you will. We're not going to change our story because we know what we've seen. It's real. It's true. And the Jewish leaders were kind of like, huh, weren't these the guys that were scared just a couple days ago? They were terrified, and all of a sudden they're bold and full of, what's wrong with these guys? Because they had seen something that was so remarkable, so transformational, it changed them completely. God changes us completely when we encounter Christ, the risen Christ. The next thing, though, is that if Christ is still in the grave, our sins are not forgiven. That wouldn't be very pleasant, would it? I know that I've done more wrong in my life than I hate to think. I wouldn't want to recount. And I thank God I've been forgiven. I couldn't bear that burden of all the things I've done or didn't do. Folks, works both ways. Our assurance of forgiveness would be worthless. Our assurance of our peace of heart, our mind, our bright hopes of the world to come would be worthless if Christ is not raised. It's all meaningless. There would be no hiding place, no mercy. We'd be no better than Muslims who would have to just hope that somehow I've done enough good to outweigh my bad. And you hope, but you never know. You're always living in fear and trauma. No such thing as grace. And grace is an amazing thing because it says that you can't do it. God already did it. He took the penalty for your sins. You don't have to. You don't have to pay the price. You don't have to do the good works to outweigh the bad works. Jesus wiped the slate clean. He washed you white as snow. You are forgiven. You are made right with God. He sees you as if you had never sinned. You are made as a child of God. What freedom there is in that. Incredible freedom. Because you're no longer carrying this weight around and saying, I've got to do more because God just might not accept me. And I better not goof up. You'll take risks when you're not afraid. You'll dare to do things that you never would dare otherwise if you were afraid. When you know you have grace covering you, you'll do magnificent, daring things for God. Because you're not doing it to win his attention. You're doing it because you already have it. The good stuff. If Christ is in the grave, then our loved ones who have died are lost. If Christ is still in the grave, then all those who have gone before us, we don't know where they are. We're having to just kind of scratch our heads and say, I hope they're there. I hope they went to heaven. Jennifer's sister passed away on Good Friday. What a wonderful day to go to be with the Lord, because Easter's just around the corner. As we sang some of these songs, we kind of looked at each other and said, you know, it says, you're celebrating and enjoying life in heaven and all healed. And we're just looking at each other, wanting to give each other a little bump because we knew exactly what Deborah is going through right now. She's experiencing joy because we know Jesus is raised. If he wasn't, we wouldn't know what would be to expect. We'd have no hope. We'd have only sadness and grief and bearing the loss of all these people who have gone before us. But when we know that Jesus has been raised, we have hope for the future. We don't grieve for those who have gone on. We celebrate. In fact, Billy Brown, she came in, she says, well, Christian's funeral should be the most celebrated time of any time of all, because we know where they're going and they're celebrating their graduation. And that's exactly right. We don't grieve. We grieve the separation. We grieve that we don't get to spend more time with them. But we celebrate because they're in a better place. They're dancing whole and complete, without sickness and pain and disease and all the other things that come. No, bodies they get will never wear out, praise God. And if Christ is still on the cross, then we of all people on earth, Christians, are to be the most pitied. If there's no resurrection, then everything that we believe crumbles into dust. It's meaningless. All the church services we've gone to, all the people that we've loved and sacrificed for and we've given our hearts to, it's meaningless. It has no purpose. Of denying ourselves of every pleasure that we could enjoy that atheists might do. We would be pitied because they say, well, look at you guys. You guys gave up everything for nothing. But I did hear a story once that an atheist was talking to a Christian, and the Christian said to him, you know, if I'm wrong, I've only lost 70 years. But if you're wrong, you've lost eternity. I read this quote this week that said, Christianity does not hold the resurrection to be one among many tenets of faith. Without faith in the resurrection, there would be no Christianity at all. The Christian church would never have begun. The Jesus movement would have fizzled out like a damp sponge with the crucifixion. Christianity stands or falls with the truth of the resurrection. If you disprove the resurrection, you disprove everything we believe in. If Christ is not raised, then we have to say, what's the point? Christianity would be nothing more than just another moral religion with rules to follow and hopes to dream of. Without a risen Savior, we have no assurance of forgiveness. We'd have no evidence of the afterlife. We'd have no hope for a future. A missionary in Turkey asked people, if I were lost and I came to a fork in the road, and I found two men, one dead and one alive, who should I ask for directions? The one that's living, of course, the Muslim said to him. He says, why then do you go to Muhammad and ask him where to go when you can go to Christ who lives and expect an answer? Everything that we have comes from Christ because he lives. I praise God that our story does not end in defeat. In verse 20, Paul writes, but the fact is that Christ has been raised from the dead. He has become the first of a great harvest of those who will be raised to life again. Earlier in that same book to the Corinthians, Paul asserted that Jesus had shown himself first to Peter, then all the other apostles, and after that he was seen by over 500 people who at the time of this writing were still alive. In other words, he's saying, go ask some of those 500 people. Go find them. I'll give you their names. He could attest. He could give them a list. If you were doing a trial and you could call 500 witnesses to a trial, do you think that's overwhelming evidence? Absolutely. Normally you get two or three people to testify and you've got plenty of weight on your hands. The message of Easter is not that there is no death. It's not that God will not let you die. It's not that your faith is easy. It's the message of Easter is that the tomb is empty. And because it's empty, those who place their hope in Jesus Christ, who place their faith in him, will have him forever in the life to come. We really have to make decisions as individuals about how we're going to respond to the person of Jesus and the resurrection. Do you believe that Jesus died as a sacrifice for your sins? Because if you've sinned once, you need something to pay for that sin. Most of us have done more than one, right? If Jesus died as a sacrifice, the Bible tells us he paid the price for your sins. And all you have to do is receive it by faith. The Bible calls it a great exchange. He gets my sins and I get all that he has. And that doesn't sound like it's very fair to God, but he loves us that much. And he also tells us that we're that valuable, that he would give us his own son, the most valuable of all that have ever existed, in exchange for us. If I give you the most valuable thing that I have, it tells you how much you're worth. Imagine God giving the most valuable thing he has for you, saying, you are worth it. That's how valuable you are. No more saying I'm worthless. No more saying I'm desperate. I'm no good. Because God says that you are. Will you embrace that truth? Will you embrace that gift that he gives you? It's your choice. The resurrection is what drove the disciples out into the world. Because it wasn't just the fact that they held on their head. They realized that the world had just been changed. That there was evidence for the next life, and that God was so real. They had seen miracles, but never a miracle like this. And they knew everything had changed. Has it driven your life? Or has it just been a fact that you kind of held your, wrapped your head around and said, yeah, the resurrection is true. I go to Easter. I'll go to Easter Sunday services. That's how I'll express my faith in the resurrection. No, the faith in the resurrection is expressed by how you live. What kind of car you drive, what kind of house you have is not as important as how you treat people, how you love them. How much money you have in the bank is not as important as how willing you are to share with others what you've been entrusted with. How successful you are in your field of work, whether academics or sports, is not as important as how faithful you are in responding and living the gospel of love. The Apostle Paul says that one day we're going to exchange these bodies for a brand new one. In fact, it's kind of neat because I love this. Sorry, I wrote the scripture down. Yeah, I did. In 2 Corinthians 5:1. Did I get it in there? He says, "For we know that if the earthly tent, that's this thing, we live in is destroyed, we have a building or a house from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands." How many of you have ever gotten in one of those pup tents, those Boy Scout pup tents, those little tents? Now they have bigger tents. They have big tents that have 3 or 4 rooms. You know, those things are pretty nice, but that canvas kind of stinks when you first unroll it and you set it up. It never really pleasant smell when you set up. You would always want to set up a day ahead of time and let it air out. But that canvas just kind of has that mildewed smell, you know what I'm talking about. And you put up a tent, and you go inside of it, it protects you from the rain, but you still get wet from the ground, and the drafts come in, it doesn't have heat, doesn't have air conditioning, and it's just kind of just enough just to, so you can spend some time out in the woods. Well, this is our time in the woods. This earth is our time in the woods. This is the place where we put up our tent, and it stinks. It's not the best building in the world. You look at some of us, and you're right. Yeah, this is not that great of a building. But we've got a better one coming. We've got a house that's being built by Jesus. He says, if I go before you, I'm going to prepare a place for you. I'm going to make a mansion for you. I'm going to build a house for you. And you can go there, because I'm going to go there, and I'm going to make it ready for you, so you can come with me. And I'm trading in this house one day for a mansion. How about you? Death is not an end. It's not a reincarnation. It's not an evaporation. Death is not an annihilation. Death is a trade-in. Christianity offers abundant life that starts now and runs all the way through eternity. One day, believers will trade this thing in for something much better.
What do you want?
I want to close with an illustration from a golfer named Paul Azinger. He was diagnosed with cancer at the age of 33. He had just won his first PGA championship and was going to eventually have 10 tournament victories to his credit. And suddenly this feeling of fear came over him. He realized he could die from cancer. And then another reality hit him even harder. I'm going to die eventually anyway, whether it's from cancer or something else. And it was just a question of when. Everything he accomplished in golf had become meaningless in that moment. He said, all that I wanted to do was live. And he remembered something that Larry Moody, who teaches a Bible study on the PGA Tour, said to him. He said, Zinger, we're not in the land of living going to the land of the dying. We're in the land of the dying getting ready to go to the land of the living. Azinger recovered with chemotherapy and returned to the PGA Tour. He's done pretty good. He's earned lots of money. But his bout with cancer deepened his perspective. He wrote, I've made a lot of money since I've been on the tour and I've won a lot of tournaments, but happiness is always temporary. The only way you'll ever have true contentment is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I'm not saying that nothing ever bothers me. I don't have problems. But I feel like I found the answer to the 6-foot hole. And it's not a putt. Jesus is the only answer to the 6-foot hole. In a few moments, we're going to have a response time and our worship team will be singing. And if you have a prayer need, maybe you have just a burden you'd like to share, have somebody pray with you, our elders will be available. Pat and Joe will be over on the side, and Jennifer, I'll be over here. We're here to pray with you, to minister to you, if you want any prayer during that time. So I invite you to just close your eyes and pray right now. Worship team will be coming up, and then we'll have our time of response. Lord God, I thank you for the resurrection. It's real. It's true.